So it's my pleasure to introduce Craig Reynolds, who we are extremely lucky to have on campus. I've known Craig for some years. We've met at conferences and such. And of course, many of you, if you've taken a game AI, know of his work. Craig is very well known for his work on voids and steering behaviors. He also has distinction of winning an Academy Award for a technical achievement as well back in 98. And one of the really cool demos that I saw, so he will correct me if I'm wrong on this, but when PS3 had just been announced and like they were showing off the first PS3 capabilities, there was this demo of like this massive school of fish that was rendered in extremely high detail with everything running real time. And my guess was that Craig's group was behind that. And so now, he's here, but at UCSC and doing very interesting things with the Expressive Intelligence Studio. And today, he's gonna talk about computational models for interactively evolving camouflage textures. So please welcome Craig. He's also, by the way, one of the nicest people in the game industry.
thanks, Arnold, for those kind words. So I'm working here on the Immerse project in the Center for Games and Playable Media. And the work on steering behaviors and crowds and flocks, I actually spoke about that a week ago Wednesday in the Game AI class, because Josh McCoy was in Boston at a conference. I wasn't planning to do this talk today, but I had kind of volunteered to do it at some point, and so this is my 10 days of talking about everything I've ever done. So I won't be talking about voids today, for a change. This is work that was first presented in 2010 at the Artificial Life Conference, and then was kind of promoted to a journal paper the following year. And you should maybe say by way of introduction that the connection between this work and games is a little tenuous, but I'll spin a couple of possible connections. One is that the interactive design is actually sort of a game with a purpose, a WAP. So there's a the computational system uses a human in the loop to provide a perceptual judgment, and so in a sense there's a game there. Also, Noah has pointed out that this work is very very much in the same camp as procedural content generation. So in the same way that you might use computational techniques to automatically generate game levels or something like this, this work is aimed towards generating visual textures. Let me dive in. So I'll talk a bit about the procedural texture synthesis system and this optimization-based technique for discovering textures with given properties, and both in a automatic mode, that is just a program running by itself, and also with the human observer in the loop. And what was driving this work was my interest in, I've done work throughout my career in modeling natural systems, and I've always been interested in the patterns we see on animals, tiger stripes, and the patterns on the back of a beetle, or it's ubiquitous in the natural world that creatures have some sort of a camouflage pattern. And I like to make computational models of things so you can play with them, you can experiment with them, possibly you can do some serious theoretical biology with them. And it also allows you to use them kind of in commercial applications like games and movies and things like that. Once you have once you put this natural phenomena in a box, then you can use it for a applications. So I guess the highest sounding motivation for the work is the idea of closing the loop between image synthesis and image perception. I'm talking here of computational synthesis and perception, and computer graphics is only the very first examples were in the 1960s, maybe the late 50s, and computer vision is an even newer topic, but they, in some sense, they're duals of each other, and I've always liked the idea of kind of pointing them at each other and somehow getting a more interesting, complex system to result. Camouflage seemed like a good example to start with, as opposed to, say, using aesthetic judgment. So you might want to have a computer system that generates a nice scene and some other computer system that looks at the scene and says, oh, well, that's kind of nice, but I'd rather have, you know, clouds in the background and the sun over here, sort of the art director kind of model. But camouflage is a more functional, subjective kind of thing. And so I think it's a more approachable problem to get started on this loop. I like the idea of combining several aspects of technology to make this model. So procedural modeling, optimization, machine learning kinds of things, and graphic arts, pulling those threads together into a cool model of a cool natural phenomenon. And I mentioned that once you have a computational model, sometimes serious biologists like Ian Cousine at Princeton has done a lot of work that kind of followed on from voids. So once you have these procedural models, then biologists can do like real science with them. Okay, so I'll be using this term goal-oriented texture synthesis, and really all I mean by that is that you have some way of doing texture synthesis, of making colored patterns, and you have some kind of general purpose optimization framework, either numerical optimization or what I'll be talking about here is evolutionary optimization, and you have some sort of goal in mind. And somewhat more specifically, what I'm talking about is a library of functions. This is actually C++ code, but that's not relevant. You have actual, just a software library of programs that manipulate texture. And then I use this technique called genetic programming. It's a variant on genetic algorithms. But essentially, it's applying evolutionary optimization to program code, to populations of programs. And then the goal or the metric is, in evolutionary computation, is called a fitness function following from Darwinian evolution in biology. The idea of this technique is to automatically discover novel kinds of images, textures, using optimization. To be able to say what you're looking for and then get a computer system to propose candidate solutions. So novel images with desired visual properties. And because these optimization techniques usually have stochastic properties, then you can, the same metric can lead to lots of potential solutions, and that's a lot like the idea of variations on a theme. So you know, if you're working with a graphic designer, and they say, how about this design? You say, oh, well, like, could you do it this way or that way? And they'll come back the next day with 10 different drawings, and so. This idea of having closely related but differing solutions to a problem. And the last point, probably, is this kind of idea where you have this, trust me that I have an evolutionary texture synthesis system, then the fitness that drives the system can be one of two types. The more common thing is automatic, where essentially, the fitness function is just a program. So in this case, it's looking at an image and giving you back a number, like a number between 0 and 1. And so 1 means this is a really good image for the criteria that we're looking at, and 0 means not so much. Conversely, Carl Sims was one of the first people to use this idea based on something that Richard Dawkins wrote about in Blind Watchmaker. But you can, instead of a program to compute the function, you can have a human. And the human looks at images or a set of images and one way or another expresses a preference. You can assign numerical scores to the image or say, I like this one better than that one. Anyway, but it involves having a human looking at pictures and assigning them a fitness. So the I have too much material. I like to talk fast because I figure that way if I say something stupid, by the time it occurs to you that I've said something stupid, I've already moved on to the next topic. So I have lots of slides. I'll be moving fast, but just to if you want to dig into this more, please get in touch, and you know I can give you a copy of the slides, or I can point you at the papers and blah blah blah. The general idea is that it's a procedural model, meaning that each image corresponds directly to a piece of software. There is this library that I referred to earlier, which is about 50 functions in the library. It's kind of a random grab bag of graphical and texture synthesis techniques. Some of them, like Perlin and Noise, that generate patterns, and other ones that modify or combine other images. And then you build up nested expressions of these operators. The code that I'll show you, they're actually constructors, and what they give you back an object which represents kind of the virtual image, which then you can probe to get the picture data out. And they're defined in a resolution-independent way, so you can make the textures kind of as fine-grained as you want. You can render them as high res as you want. Okay, so this is actually the library that I used. I don't expect you to get anything from that other than to kind of see how many there are. These are handwritten examples using that library. These are all very short programs. These are actually from the diary I kept while I was generating the library. Checking to see that the color is approximately what I'm expecting. Each of these images is like two or three lines of code. So it's a fairly high level representation for different kinds of patterns. And I'm sure there are some blind spots in the way I put together the library that, you really couldn't make an image like this, or it would be hard to, or something like that. But I think there's sort of enough in the function set that you have sort of a universality. I like to pretend like I'm touring, so that you have enough of these functions in your library that you can pretty much get any image out. Yeah, I don't have any formal proof or anything. So these are slightly different. These are not written by hand. They were discovered by the optimization technique that I'm referring to. And I'll get back to what the metric was, but these are just kind of examples of how you get interesting combinations by letting the optimization procedure search over this gigantic image space. So this shows the duality between an image and the source code. So this is evolved source code, so I don't expect it to mean anything to you, it doesn't to me. You'll see things like repeated genes, like there's two identical lines here, and some of the numbers and the two-dimensional vector values are the same, because these are floating around in the genome and they get reused and repurposed and modified and remixed. This texture actually came out of the camouflage work. I'll show you it in context later on, but an equally unreadable but different source code. This was camouflage for some oak bark, and I'll show you these examples later. But sort of interesting because it's relatively compact. The amount of code there is smaller than the previous two. And I indented it like a human programmer would. And I just want to take it apart a little bit. What you see is a call to a colorize function, which has two arguments. This one is a noise function. Furbulence is a variation on Turbulence, which was one of Ken Perlin's original, in his A-Texture synthesizer paper in 85. So this is that underlying texture. And then Colorize is going to do a color mapping, like a density slicing. And the color map is actually the pixels that lie along this positive x-axis of the texture space. So this is a texture that's defined throughout the two-dimensional space, but we just look at the part from 0 to 1 and use that as the mapping from the brightness of the noise function to A, blah, blah. So you're just going down through the sub-expressions here, and then this is the underlying noise that, you know, is put together to make that. And then this is the combined thing. Anyway, again, you're not supposed to think that the code makes sense. I'm just trying to point out how it kind of combines together. All right, and this is, I said that you could either use a program to measure the fitness of an image, or you could have a human express an opinion. This is on the program side. So I showed you these before. This is with a metric that's sort of just looking for non-degenerate color images. So there's some amount of color variation. You go from darks to lights in the image, and there's a criteria that has to do with frequency distribution. So that led to these sorts of things. And these are all high scoring on that metric, as would almost any well-exposed color photograph. This is the definition for a metric where you're looking for a pattern that's a gray texture that has some accent color in it. So here's a couple of those. Here's a bunch of those. Here's another bunch of those. Here's some where the gray was biased towards dark, so on. This example, the images are high frequency at the top, low frequency at the bottom. So you can write lots of these filters. There's an idea in color theory kind of summed up by this diagram. So red and cyan, for example, are antipodal, they're complementary hues. And if you take these sort of off complementary values, then these three colors are referred to as a harmonious color triplet. So I was evolving some textures where the criteria was having a texture, having colors like that. I was just looking, is there a clock in here? I'll use this. Okay. So, finally, back to camouflage. So, I'm going to express this one more time. Abstract model of the evolution of camouflage in nature. It uses evolutionary computation as an analog of natural Darwinian evolution. The computer graphics part is this procedural texture synthesis stuff that I've been talking about. And it's a hybrid system with a human visual system in the loop. So here are some examples. Okay. Let me explain what's going on in these pictures. So this is a little piece clipped out of, say, a screen-sized image. But the background here is a bit of a photograph from the natural world. And I thought it was important to use natural images to have the right sort of complexity, to not use, you know, like super clean synthetic images, cartoon-like images. So this is a bit of my neighbor's hedge. And then in the center is a disk of the synthetic texture, which has been evolved to be inconspicuous, to be cryptic against this background. And I've kept the size of these sample disks the same throughout the experiments. Okay, so going back, this is a piece of oak bark, again with each of these has a synthetic texture in the center. This is a polished piece of serpentine, which is a mineral. It's the state mineral of California, so remember serpentine. These are lantana flowers in my backyard. I showed you the hedge. This is some kind of sculpture with this. This work has been made much easier by the huge number of images that are available on the web. I'm using either Creative Commons or copyrighted images where people were willing to give me permission to use them. But there are lots of those. Okay, and this is sort of what,
Does it use only that one particular image or a bunch of those images of similar things?
That's a good point. I'm using a single image now. It would make a lot of sense to have several related images and maybe select randomly among them for each test each time you presented a new one. And in fact, it gets into the topic of generalization because in the natural world, most creatures will be on a collection of different sorts of substrates, so they need to be cryptic on each of them. And, but yes, in these experiments, I was using exactly one background image. The samples are placed randomly on it each time. So this is kind of what the human user would see towards the end of a run. So it's the background photograph of this polished serpentine stone. And then on it, there are 10 bits of camouflaged texture. So mostly what you see is the boundary of the little round patches. So you can see things here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There's a nice one here. I particularly like that one. Yeah, I think I missed one. All right, there are 10. So this system, this natural system, which I'm kind of making a hand wave model of, is that there is a co-evolutionary dynamic that goes on between the predators who are using their, all of their senses, but particularly in this case, their visual sense, to identify prey. They're out there, they're hungry, they're looking for food, and they want to find something to eat, and from the point of view of the prey, the harder they are to see, the more likely they are to survive. In both cases, the name of the game is to live long enough to have offspring. I mentioned Dawkins before. One of his books was The Selfish Gene, and the idea is that humans are just DNA's way of making more DNA, and it's the same for all species. So the way you win in this game is by living long enough to reproduce, and as we all know, that's a complicated thing. Go to college, get a job, so. But basically, these two systems are in competition with each other, forming a co-evolutionary arms race, they call it. So in nature, the way camouflage is created generally falls into the idea of morphogenesis, shape synthesis, and there's a bunch of genes that have to do with the way patterning, the way shapes happen, the variations between, say, people's faces. These things are all genetically encoded, and some of them in an animal like, say, a butterfly, are specifically to encode those colored patterns that you see on their wings, which have to do with camouflage and also social signaling and other kinds of things that help the creature survive. So, yeah, evolution of this idea of morphogenesis, and on the other side, the predator, lots of things going on to make a tiger, but particularly the evolution of an excellent visual system and part of the brain that's analyzing that visual input and understanding what's going on out in the world. So in the system that I'm talking about right now, I explained how this is kind of procedural texture synthesis and evolutionary computation, and the vision part is done by having a human actually looking at the pictures and deciding which things are more camouflage, less cryptic, more conspicuous. Several ways of saying that. Where I'd like to go in the future is to replace that human observer with sort of a computer vision system. They call it, a machine learning, computer vision, line between the two is kind of fuzzy. But want to use what's called online learning, meaning that instead of having your data set at the beginning, it kind of comes to you over time, and you try to improve your performance. So as the prey gets more camouflaged, then the predator has to learn better how to detect them. But that's future work. All right. So this is the National Geographic part of the talk. So these are natural images and I'll kind of zip through but point out some of the interesting bits. I love this picture. This is a thing called a lantern fly. I think it's about maybe 2 inches long. It has the unfortunate ecological niche of living in the forest canopy. This picture was probably taken about 100 feet off the floor of the forest by some really gutsy biologist hanging from, mountain climbing ropes. And my work, I sit at my desk and type. These guys have to dangle from ropes 100 feet off the ground while trying to do macro photography. Anyway, what I was going to point out was that not only is there background matching going on here, so the colors that you find in the background, like the bright greens and the dark parts that come from the shadows and the light parts that come from the highlights off these presumably wet moss, you see all those colors reflected here. The pattern is a passable imitation of the background. But the other thing that's going on is that if you look at the silhouette edge here of the carapace and the wing cover, you'll see that there are little features that are aligned perpendicular to the edge. And in fact, you get the impression often that a feature continues across. Like, see right here, there's a little bit of green here, and a little green, it almost looks like it's the same thing. So what's happening there is that this is called a disruptive camouflage pattern. It's trying to screw with the edge finding image processing that happens at a very low level in your visual system. So it's trying to say, no, there's no edge here, nothing's happening here, just move along. There's nothing to eat. So, all right. So I'm not going to talk that long about these other pictures. I'm just hoping to amaze you. Here's a nice little caterpillar doing a great job of looking like the leaf that it's on. This is a moth on some tree bark. This is a bug. There's a type of insect that's actually called a bug. This is a bark bug. This is a spider. You'll be forgiven if you can't see him, but he's kind of here in the center. This is another kind of spider called a crab spider. He's doing what they do. They sit usually on a flower near a nectar source. And you see that he's got his arms, his four of his legs kind of out. He's waiting for a bee or a fly or something to come down and go for the nectar, at which point, amazingly fast, the legs come together and he grabs the insect and has lunch. This is another crab spider who has just gotten something to eat. And I love this picture because the substrate that he's on is kind of white flowers with little bits of red, and there's green stems, and look at the spider. He's got all those colors. All right. Sometimes when I mention this topic, people think more about camouflage change and dynamic camouflage. So I should point out that I'm really more talking about the permanent. It happens during embryological development and then stays with you through life. But there are other amazing dynamics in camouflage. So like this snowshoe hare that changes from brown to white with the seasons, the crab spider that I was talking about, they adjust to the substrate that they're sitting on over a few days or weeks. It's a lovely picture of a chameleon. Although I've heard that chameleon coloration has more to do with social signaling than camouflage, but they can certainly blend in with the greenery. And this is one of my favorite animals. so the cuttlefish, their skin is essentially like the flat screen display. It changes instantly. They can make patterns. The patterns can move around. I mean, they do graphics. They do animation. They're really cool animals. There's a little lizard on a rock. This is a fish, a sole, on a sandy bottom. There's a little shrimp on another thing called a crinoid. So the black and white coloration, the thing that he's walking around on is a primitive animal, a little like a sea anemone or something, although it's armored. And this animal that always lives on him looks just like him. There's a couple of owls doing a great job of looking like that tree trunk. There's another owl. So this picture is one of my favorites. I used to say artist unknown. I now know it's actually a copyrighted photo, but I just found out that this professional photographer called Art Wolf, so I shouldn't use this. It came from one of those clickbait sites, where they steal people's artwork and use it to trick you into watching their ads. But yeah, this picture is amazing. If it wasn't for the symmetry in the owl's face, he would be effectively invisible. He's helped some because of the indirect lighting, so you don't get the shape from shading cues that you might otherwise get. But yeah, that's an astounding picture. So here's a common Rama Pippins. This is like a very, particularly in the east, northeast. And this is a closely related frog that lives further south, in Florida, I think. One of the things I think is nice about this, if you imagined like military camouflagers, if they had a tank that had kind of desert camouflage, but the tank had to operate in the forest, you could imagine them just kind of going out and slopping some green paint on it. This is exactly what this guy looks like. He said, okay, I got this nice brown camouflage frog. Oh, the substrate's green. Well, no problem. I'll just dash a little green in there. It's another camouflage somewhere in toad from Europe was apparently evolved to look like this concrete walkway. This is another cement frog. This is a gecko in Madagascar. In case you can't quite see him, so his head's down here. They spend the day just stuck onto tree trunks like this. This is an equally cryptic animal that just happens to be on the wrong substrate. It's illustrating how important that choice of substrate is. And a nice picture of an acacia tree and a giraffe. So the guy who took this picture had walked out of his bus and walked over to the acacia tree before he noticed the giraffe standing there. You look at the pattern on a giraffe, I'm talking too much about this, and you might think, wow, he comes from a place that's kind of orange and black, and I don't quite get that. But in fact, in a context like this, you see that it's a really good match to the sort of dapple illumination under that tree. Okay. So, I should be moving faster. There are details here about the evolutionary computation, which I think most of you aren't that interested in. I will make this point about genetic programming. If you know anything about genetic algorithms, it generally operates on bit strings that are sort of an analog of DNA base pairs. But genetic programming uses a tree-shaped genome. And so I'm using here just single-letter function names the way you might write them in program code. But the idea is you have these two parents, these two parent programs. You select a portion of each of them, and you end up with this crossover. So it's sort of random cut and paste on program code, which on first blush always seems like a particularly goofy idea. But it turns out that under the right circumstances, this not only works, but allows you to create programs that have interesting properties. So if you engineering computation, the main idea is that you have a bunch of candidate solutions called a population. So these, in the experiments here, each of the little green dots represents one of those. They are, one of the things that's done is you divide those into neighborhoods or means. And so this is kind of a diagram of what's going on in the computation. So there are the four deems. Occasionally an individual will move from one to the other. That's what the white arrows are. There's a mixture of new ones and old ones that have to do with the predation, deciding which ones survive. And then I showed you one picture of a step in this algorithm with the 10 candidate textures. So that would be one of these. So there's 10 of them, roughly half and half, new and old, that are presented to the user each time around. I'll show one more nature picture just to kind of motivate the graphics, the imagery that I use. So if you look at this spider's abdomen here, which, by the way, I think is a fantastic pattern. It's kind of an art nouveau, like something you'd find in a theater lobby or something. I really like that. But what you have is a hard-edged, roundish thing. Beetle's carapace would be the same way. With disruptive patterns on it. And this is meant to be kind of a natural example of the kinds of texture samples that I'm using, which otherwise just sort of look like unmotivated round disks of texture. But this is kind of what I had in mind. Okay, too many words, move to the picture. So I will step through one interaction cycle with this program. So I mentioned that this is done with a human in the loop. I should say that I don't subject other people to this. I've been the human in the loop, which raises issues of experimenter bias and things like that. But this is how it works. You start with a blank screen, you click on it, and you see a picture like this. So it's the photographic background. This is the lichen picture, the yellow lichen. And overlaid on it is a cohort, a group of 10 sample textures. So the user is instructed, or I know that what you're supposed to do is find the most conspicuous one and click on it. Okay, so I'm using this goofily large mouse pointer. So click on that guy, and that bright yellow one disappears. So then you just repeat this 5 times. So I'm going to get rid of half of the cohort. So maybe this one is the most conspicuous after that. This one, each time we're removing one of the samples from the background, allowing you then to figure out which of the remaining ones are more conspicuous. And let's say that one. Okay. So having done that, I'm obviously not able to count up to 5. Okay. Having done that, that's the end of the cycle. So we started with 10 of them, a mixture of new and old ones, and we judged their relative quality. Relative fitness. So when you look at them all together, which one stands out even more than its neighbors? Okay, so the ones you clicked on are then removed from the population, and after you've done this to all of the textures in the population, then you create new ones to replace the ones that you've taken out. And that's done through a model of reproduction. The reproduction model, as I showed you, of the two programs being mashed together. That's how the surviving members of the population are remixed into new programs, which create new textures. Okay. So in a typical run, do about 1,000 of those cycles that I just showed you, meaning about 10,000 individuals get looked at. This means about 5,000 mouse clicks by the human. I spent a couple of months doing that. Click, click. And it's kind of time consuming. But if you're listening to good music, it's okay. All right, so we saw this and these are some of the individuals on that background. really good job, slightly more saturated than the flowers themselves, the purple part, and the green side. It's not exactly right, but it's pretty close. It's hard to pick out. And this is what the whole cohort looks like, with the kind of screen-sized image and 10 of the camouflage things. So I should say that the little thumbnails, those are the greatest hits. Those are the ones that I picked out looking that I thought were particularly well hidden. So these are more typical examples. All right, we hit this lichen. And I should say the pictures, the thumbnails here are arranged from early in the run to late in the run. So basically, they're supposed to be getting better over time. And again, the collection of a bunch of examples. So there were some interesting things that happened in this run. First of all, I think the quality of the camouflage was very good. Part of it was that there was only one color, so it could kind of quickly converge on being in the right color place, and then it spent the rest of the run trying to figure out the textural aspects of it. But one of the things that I thought were particularly interesting, if you see this, know anything about graphic design, it's really common to do this thing where you have a shape and then you have a darkened region under it of the same shape and then you drop shadow. Actually, that's kind of going out of favor. Lots of websites and like the iOS 7 has gone to what they call the flat look. So instead of having little highlights and shadows on things, generally they're more simplified graphically. But the fact that this thing kind of popped out was really fun for me, because the background is in fact a bunch of roundish green things that cast shadows on each other, and that it kind of discovered that as it was using this stochastic search procedure was very fun. And so this is near the end of the run. There's some very cool textures in here, which I won't belabor, but this is a nice representation of this guy here. Last night I was trying to pick out the 10 of them, and I think I only got to 9. So. All right, and this is actually a recent run. These are beach pebbles somewhere in England, another picture off the web. So you see it going from a very wacky, poor matches early in the run to ones that look a lot like the substrate. Okay. And I'll just point out, using that last example, I mentioned that I want to be able to build a computer vision system that can make this discrimination itself. In machine learning, one of the things you always have to worry about is dimensionality reduction. So your data, you have far too much data. You have to figure out how to throw some of it away in a principled way. There's things like principal component analysis and clustering and various techniques. One of the things that is probably will work in this example is to take a two-dimensional image and compose it into a series of transects of a line of pixels. So, in fact, what's going on here is that in this image, each row is the pixels across the center of one of those little disks of synthetic texture. So, starting with a disk, then I'm retaining just the row of pixels across the center, and then I've stacked them up, and these are in time order. So you see some of them at the beginning are wacky colors that don't have anything to do with the image. And then when you're doing supervised machine learning, you need positive examples and negative examples. You know, this is the thing we're looking for, this is the opposite of the thing we're looking for. So these are just random disks cut out of the background image, and then similarly, I took the row of pixels across the center of it. So one of the things about this is that while these, I thought the camouflage was getting pretty good at the end of this run, I think when you look at the two of these, it's clear that there are strong statistical differences between the two. For example, these have much darker pixels in them. These have less contrast over here. So I'm pretty confident that a machine learning system could handle this as an online classification task of being able to tell whether a given sample belonged to this class or to this class. There are open questions about what you need to learn versus what you see. So I think this is an easy thing to learn, but the future work will have to do with learning what actually makes something cryptic, these ideas of disruptive camouflage around the edge, and so on. So I'm going to leave it there. I'd like to point out, because I have this obsession now with camouflage, I'm always looking for cool images. So I love the dog camouflaged in the truck engine. And presumably not the result of evolution. This is also a couple of guys, apparently at Dragon Con, who scouted out the hotel where it was held beforehand and made uniforms to match the carpet in the hotel. I really like that one. So anyway, thank you for paying attention, and I'm happy to take questions. Yes. There's this guy, Endler, a biologist who worked with a very similar idea in nature. He studied guppies, you know, fish. Do you know this work? So I'm kind of an amateur biologist, so I get into that kind of stuff. But what he found was the connection between the presence of predators, which made the guppies tend to be more camouflaged. And when there weren't predators, then the males would have very bright colors, which appealed to for female mate selection. And you could, he was able to get these evolutionary effects to happen within just a couple of months. So he took like colonies of guppies and brought them in. So anyway, I'm sure that would, did you have more?
I guess on a religion note, do you think that there's a way that you could feed the texture animal some information about the part of the image, like the specific part of the image that is under it, and have it be sort of like online adaptive versus offline adaptive?
I'm sure that could be done, and so then it becomes a little more like a chameleon or something, right?
Yeah.
Where it reacts to it, or the I guess the cuttlefish is probably a better example of that, where a lot of the cuttlefish's brain seems to be this mapping between its visual system and the chemophores on its skin. I'm sure that could be done. I also will say, when I've given this talk before, occasionally questions come up about military camouflage, and I say, oh yeah, I'm not interested in that stuff. But I was approached by somebody who was doing military contracting, and they wanted me to look into it. And after using this approach to try to match some landscape photographs of a particular area, Afghanistan, I was able to come up with camouflage that I thought did a pretty good job. But it occurred to me that making the system not know about the background image was probably not helping in that category. So certainly, the way a tiger's stripes came about had nothing to do with its skin looking at the background. It was just this indirect effect. But if you're particularly, as an engineering problem, if you're trying to match some particular kind of background, I think it makes sense to just grab samples out of the background and use a technique like this to figure out a good way to combine them into a... And in fact, you can buy... The markets for camouflage are military and hunters, and I've seen hunter camouflage where they sort of just use Photoshop. They take a bunch of pictures of branches and leaves and things, and then kind of weave them together into a pattern that, that looks a lot like the background that you're going into. And, yeah. Not directly. The lowest level things that actually create the textures are a bunch of variations on Perlin noise, some of which he talked about in his original 85 paper, and then I have some variations. And some things like gratings, stripes, and a couple of circular features. And When I was really thinking about this, I thought, well, reaction diffusion textures seem like a natural thing if you're familiar with those. And you know, the last paper that Alan Turing wrote was about reaction diffusion textures because he was interested in this issue, you know, where do tiger stripes come from? And so he was starting to build very abstract models of chemical substrates. And it turns out that a couple of years ago, geneticists have actually identified the activator suppressor molecules that are reagents that operate just like the things that Turing was proposing. So I haven't used pretty much any computational technique that generates a pattern could be used in a context like this. So I'm not using cellular automata. That's a good idea. I think probably the next thing I would try is actually using reaction fusion textures.
Yeah. Are the functions deterministic?
Yes. I originally had some texture generators that had random number calls in them, but I took those out because they kind of add some trouble. So yes. So I've been friends with Ken Perlin for a long time, but even if we weren't buddies, one of the reasons his work is just so amazingly significant is that, I don't know if you're familiar with Perlin noise, but the you have this thing that looks very random, but it's actually deterministic. The Boyd's model is actually in that same category where you can have completely deterministic rules that lead to very hard to predict, complex results. And it's really just it's that chaotic dynamics. So the original Lorentz attractor was a very simple mathematical model that would generate these unpredictable patterns based on an initial condition. So anyway, yes, all deterministic. All right, well, if that's it, thanks again, and contact me if you want to talk more about this.